welcome from wherever you are. I'm Tairo Hassan, the director of Brightline Initiative. And Brightline is a project management institute initiative dedicated to help organizations and executives bridge the gap between strategy design and strategy delivery. How do you take ideas and do you transform them into reality? Today, we are privileged to have Terence Maori with us. Terence is the founder of Hack Future Lab, a global management think tank that helps leaders to navigate deep uncertainty and complex future. He has been described as an outspoken and influential thinker on the future of leadership by Thinkers 50. And he holds entrepreneur in residence roles at MIT and London Business School. His new book, if you haven't seen it, The 3D Leader, Take Your Leadership to the Next Dimension, has been shortlisted for the CMI Business Book of the Year. Congratulations, Terence.
Thank you very much, Tairo.
Excellent. So we are here today with a special theme, and our theme is about the 5 tips for transforming leadership now. So we're talking about now, not tomorrow. And as you know, a new future is on the horizon, and one that we know is different from what the world was before. It will be more turbulent, it is less predictable, it is more complex, it is less simple, more varied, and less knowable. It doesn't help really that our minds and brains are hardwired to dislike uncertainty, and so sometimes we tend to avoid it. And as this restless future takes shape, there is no room for anyone to cling to the past. The question then that is before us, will we watch the world change around us, or will we be the one leading it? The future journey and the future leadership journey really needs a compass. It needs a compass to allow us to navigate change and to move organizations in the future. And we are fortunate again to have Terence, who will guide us on the journey to reimagine relevancy across leadership and ultimately how to turn uncertainty into action. So I'll give the floor to Terence. He'll go through the presentation, and toward the end, through this conversation, toward the end, we'll make some room for Q&A to take the audience question, because we want to hear from you, we want to engage with you, and we want you to have the best experience as part of this discussion. Terence, whenever you're ready, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Tairo, for the warm introduction and a warm welcome to everybody. Today, I want to give you the equivalent of a double espresso to challenge your thinking and to get you thinking about reimagination as the new execution. Change, it used to happen as a breeze. Now it feels like a Category 5 typhoon. Over the last 18 months, everything changed. The office changed. Technology changed. People changed. And our priorities changed. So the question is, do you watch the world change around you, or will you be the one leading it? What questions do you want to be remembered for? What's the bravest question you can ask today? I believe to create a fearless culture, a culture of innovation, a culture of courage, questions are the answer. And questions are actually one of the most underrated tools in the leader's toolbox. So what questions do you want to be remembered for? If you stop for 3 minutes every day to ask new types of questions, new questions to old problems, new questions to new problems, that's 24 hours of new questions a year. Questions are like the golden key that can unlock the door and help you see the world differently. They can help you have the curiosity to learn, but also the courage to unlearn. So here are 5 big catalytic questions we're going to dive into today. Number one, how do you transform your leadership for today and tomorrow? You need to be in a perpetual state of beta, learning, unlearning, and relearning. Number two, how do you outpace the forces of workforce disruption, talent disruption, and of course, business model disruption? I think one of the best ways to outpace disruption is through great transformative leadership. Question three, how do you win with empathy, balancing empathy and economics, moving from a leadership style of command and control to care and co-creation? Satya Nadella said recently that, in fact, care is the new leadership currency in a hybrid world. Question four, do you lead with new world DNA or old world DNA? I'll expand on this definition soon, but what I mean by that is moving from return on investment, which is clearly important, but also new human metrics for new world DNA, return on intelligence, return on integrity, return on imagination, because remember, every organization started as an act of imagination. And finally, and it's a big question for you to think about today, what do you say no to or unlearn or reimagine to lead 10x smarter, braver, or bolder? Remember, you need the curiosity to learn in the 21st century, but also the courage to unlearn. Learning helps us to evolve, and unlearning helps us to keep up as the world evolves. So, takeaway, practical takeaways. Number one, what questions do you want to be remembered for? Next time you are addressing a pain point, an organizational challenge, a cultural pain point, start with questions. Identify the pain point. Think about new questions to that pain point, but suspend answering none for 10 minutes. And then finally, at the end of those 10 minutes, pick one, two, or three great new catalytic questions that disrupt the status quo and help you reimagine relevancy. It feels like the future arrives faster than ever before. A couple of months ago, I received an email from an executive assistant. Her name was Amy Ingram. And the purpose of the email was to organize a meeting with her CEO. When I got to meet with him, he asked me a very strange question. What did I think of Amy? What a strange question to ask. He then said to me, I have a confession. Amy is not human. She's AI. And the clue is in her initials. Amy Ingram, artificial intelligence. Well, I can tell you that my first reaction was embarrassment. I've been having a conversation with Amy Ingram. My second reaction was paranoia. I kept looking over my shoulder. Was I part of a Black Mirror Netflix film? But my third reaction was, this is not the age of disruption. This is the age of wonder. Cars that can drive themselves, platforms that can anticipate our every needs, robots capable of everything from advanced manufacturing to complex surgery. And so what this means for you is that you need to master the new logic of leadership. What do I mean by that? You're now competing on learning. You're competing on ecosystems. In fact, over the next 7 years, ecosystems will represent over $77 trillion worth of revenue potential. You're competing on physical and digital or fidgetal. You're competing on imagination and intelligence and integrity. And you're competing on resilience and anti-fragility, the ability to bounce back and bounce forward from disruption. And remember, disruption can come from many ways, from many areas, unhappy customers, broken business models, legacy systems, or indeed a strategy that protects outdated success. So you need to master the new logic of leadership. Here we can see research from Hack Future Lab of a number of forces that are converging that mean that we need to reimagine at a faster rate. Yes, it's true, we are deluged by digital. According to Gartner, over 175 zettabytes of information over the next 5 years. That's 66 times all the grains of sand. Yes, disruption, in fact, business model disruption in particular, workforce disruption is accelerating. And business models are going off like yogurt in the fridge. But I want to plant a narrative in the here and now, because you are still in the driving seat. The history of humanity and the history of leadership is a history of disruption. Stone Age, Bronze Age, Iron Age, and now this age of AI and algorithm and data. Disruption means two words, risk and opportunity. 100,000 years ago, we harnessed fire, which led to language. 10,000 years ago, we developed agriculture. 5,000 years ago, we invented writing and the wheel. And today, you stand at a new inflection point. Here we can see research from ARK Investments, headed up by Catherine Wood, looking at the impact of these exponential technologies on equity market capitalizations. Over the last 20 years, around $13.7 trillion has been added to equity market capitalizations. In the last 2 years, $2 trillion has been added to equity market capitalizations, with organizations reinventing their business models by replatforming to the cloud and reimagining around data, analytics, and AI. The projection for the next 20 years is an extra $30 trillion of equity market capitalization, seeing this convergence of blockchain, robotics, AI, and the cloud that is upending the way that organizations work. Here's a couple of examples. Klarna, a decacorn disrupting the $8 trillion credit card market. We have CDBCs, central bank digital currencies, SPACs, special purpose acquisition companies. Only recently, a hedge fund called Engine One won a proxy war with ExxonMobil to get three directors onto the board, focusing on driving inclusive growth and sustainability. So, as leaders, you need to transform your leadership and your business and your culture, not tomorrow, not next year, today. I think there are four big forces that are disrupting leadership today. Number one, optimize reality. What I mean by that is moving from fragmented control to networked resilience, business models that are engineered around data, algorithm, and cloud. According to Hack Future Labs research, around 20 to 25% of companies have replatformed to the cloud today. And over the next 5 years, we're going to see an exponential growth reaching over 80% replatforming, not just businesses, but entire industries and ecosystems. Number two, a major force that's disrupting the way that we lead is ethical impact. It's time to reject the economist Milton Friedman's economic logic that the sole purpose of a company is to generate shareholder value. We're moving from shareholder value to stakeholder value. A click future, clean, lean, inclusive, and circular. And what this means for you as a leader is that you need to prioritize ESG, social change, inclusive growth, and sustainability. That means focusing on economics of the business, but also ecological benefits. A great example of this is B Corporations, which balance social purpose and profit. Danone, the food company, is one of the biggest B Corporations on the planet today. Okay, force number three that is impacting the way that you lead, which means that you need to reimagine relevancy across your culture, your growth strategies, and your leadership, is the race to reskill. According to the World Economic Forum, over the next 10 years, over 1 billion jobs will be displaced. We need to focus on humanity over bureaucracy, not just profit maximization, but human maximization. Every job title is being disrupted. Recent ones I've come across include innovation Sherpa, distraction prevention coach, tech philosopher, and my personal favorite, director of disruption, who confessed to me his job title was as popular as a funeral director. But on a serious note, one of the best ways to outpace the forces of regulatory, business, customer disruption is choosing a perpetual state of beta. Are you a learner or a knower? Okay, force number four is a big one. It's the new meta. Meta is like changing the rules of the game halfway through. Imagine that you're playing chess, and halfway through, the rules and the constraints of that game are fundamentally upended. This is what the new meta means. It means that competitive lines are being redrawn. We have unicorns, decacorns, which are $10 billion valuation companies, and hectocorns, $100 billion valuations. I discovered recently that the number 29 biggest company on the planet is a Chinese hector corn. It's called Mutai, and it's China's number one liquor. It's got a market capitalization of nearly $400 billion. That's more than MasterCard. So this is the new meta. We have new companies already in the cloud that are appending the normal rules of the game. So what does this mean for you? I want you to take a strategic pause. Everybody keeps telling me that data is the new oil. Research at HapFuture Lab shows that up to 75% of data is still not used. I believe that attention is the new oil. And then in this attention extraction economy, your leadership attention is a non-negotiable. Knowledge is just bits of data. Connecting them is wisdom and turning that information into actionable insights. I want you to think about three types of attention today, which are transformative. Number one is inner attention. What are your blind spots and what are you blind to? Number two is other attention, being aware of your teams around you. We know that solidarity and social connection, risk of burnout, techno stress has diminished over the last 18 months. So other attention is absolutely key. It's about we, not me, in terms of leadership success. And finally, number three is outer attention. What's your point of view on hard trends, soft trends, and weak signals? And it's not just about having a point of view. I want you to think about three strategies. Do you one, watch these trends and weak signals closely? Do you two, take decisive action? Or do you three, simply observe? So attention is the new oil, leadership attention. If you want to amplify shared purpose, shared commitment, higher levels of contribution, and a challenger culture, a culture that has the urgency to learn and the courage to unlearn, you need to activate three catalysts today. Number one is what I call harness uncertainty. As I said, change, it used to happen as a breeze. Now it feels like a Category 5 typhoon. Uncertainty is at record levels. We've got blurring of industry lines, economic and geopolitical uncertainty, disruptive technologies such as AI and automation, shrinking of company, product lifespans, even job lifespans, and a global pandemic. In this new operating environment, not taking a risk is a risk. So we have uncertainty on steroids. Uncertain times require certainty of purpose. Here, in collaboration with MIT, we've identified seven major sources of loss, drivers of uncertainty in the workplace that have been amplified and accelerated and created really practical but also existential risk for organizations. In fact, there's over $41 trillion of enterprise at risk today due to uncertainty and business model disruption. But at a very human level, what are these big seven potential losses that you and your team are suffering from or thinking about or have anticipatory anxiety? Well, they can include loss of attachment, loss of future, loss of status or hierarchy, even loss of meaning and loss of identity. I think the last 18 months, in a way, has created a high degree of liminality. What I mean by that is we have one foot in one world, a pre-pandemic world, which was very comfortable. And now we have one foot in a new and still highly unknowable world. And that liminality creates hope, but also fear. In fact, I want to help you turn uncertainty into possibility and disruption into opportunity. Our brains are hardwired to dislike uncertainty, and then we avoid it. But this is not a good strategy when uncertainty is high and the number of tail risks, low probability, high impact, is higher than ever before. So we need to harness uncertainty as a catalyst. And what I mean by that is, if I give you a clear definition, it's about harnessing uncertainty as a tailwind for renewal, reinvention, reimagination, and transformation. Harnessing it as a catalyst for change. As I said, we are suffering the highest levels ever of anticipatory anxiety, worry about the future. We're worried about jobs. We're worried about our companies. We're worried about our partners. We're worried about automation. And this is an innovation killer. And so we can reduce anticipatory anxiety and we can reduce uncertainty by activating purpose and putting purpose to work every day. We all know what we do. We all know how we do it, but only a few of us know why we do what we do. Research at Hack Future Lab shows there's a purpose dividend, higher returns on equity of 13.1%. We are more engaged, more innovative, and higher levels of intellectual contribution, ROI, return on investment. Here we have a great example of harnessing uncertainty and activating purpose as a tailwind for renewal and transformation. I truly believe that to thrive in this restless, turbulent world, we need to choose a mindset, a culture set, a heart set, a perpetual beta. Remember, that's a curiosity to learn and the courage to unlearn at speed and scale. Here we have a great story of transformation. The former CEO, Henrik Poulsen, he was the CEO of a Danish company called DONG, Danish Oil Natural Gas Company. And it was the one of the world's biggest polluters, biggest coal companies. This was 10 years ago, or just 120 months. What they decided to do was move from a present forward strategy, which is what most companies do, by the way. A present forward strategy is where you just extend the existing business model, the existing thinking, the existing assumptions and orthodoxies into the future. And most companies get trapped in a present focus strategy. What DONG did, what Henrik Poulsen at DONG did, was decide to commit to a future back strategy. A future back strategy means that you fast forward into the future and you work your way back to anticipate relevancy, to exploit the weak trends and early signals, but also to eliminate outdated business models, outdated leadership, outdated ways of thinking. So this was a 10-year transformation journey. They updated the company name to Ørsted, and they, over 10 years, they shifted from a coal company to a wind operating farm company. In fact, the world's biggest today, with a market capitalization of nearly $400 billion. A couple of key learnings here. One, they decided to energize the core. And this is lesson number one. Energizing the core means updating your culture, your mindset, your leadership, your growth strategies, your operating model to the new reality and mastering the new context. So they energized the core. Two, they reimagined growth engines, not just new business models, new markets, but also new mindsets for the new context. For example, moving from bossed to unbossed, from control to care and co-creation, from ego to eco, from hierarchies to networks and communities. And then finally, number three, they committed to inclusive and sustainable growth. That means balancing both the economics of a business, but also the ecological impact. It's a great example of courage, of the tenacity to turn talk into action, of harnessing uncertainty as a tailwind and rejecting disruption as a constraint. I want you to reject this constraint, this mental constraint that disruption just happens to you. It's possible to turn disruption from a headwind to a tailwind and use it as a catalyst, if you like, for renewal, reinvention, and a perpetual state of beta. In Japanese, they call it henka. It means transcendence. It's like a moth to a butterfly or turning into gold. So, catalyst number one for you to think about today to transform your leadership and to choose a perpetual state of beta is to harness uncertainty as a tailwind. It means to activate purpose across the ecosystem. What's catalyst number two then? Catalyst number two is rethinking trust. I believe that I define trust as a confident relationship in the unknown. So it's at the heart of every action, relationship, and transaction. And I think it's time to rethink the importance of trust. ethical, digital, financial, emotional. Hack Future Lab research shows that 10 out of 15 industries have suffered major trust breaches over the last 3 years. And we have some big examples. VW emission scandal, McKinsey opioid scandal, Boeing MAX 737, Wirecard in Europe, and the list goes on. Research at Hack Future Lab shows that 4 out of 10 people have felt under pressure to compromise on ethics and compliance. And this is backed up by Endelman, the Trust Index, which shows significant declines in trust, a crisis of trust in governments, in the pandemic, in the business models, and in our futures. I call this the age of truth decay. And if you think about it, trust is the ultimate human currency, especially when you're operating in a hybrid environment. Here we can see an example, a story, and some concrete lessons of the dangers of operating at the edge of ethics. Here we have Elizabeth Holmes, former founder of Theranos. Theranos was a transformative success story. It reached a $10 billion valuation in less than 3 years. And its business model was built around this proprietary technology, this innovation technology, which could test blood in new ways. Right now, if you've been following the press, you'll know that there is a significant lawsuit happening right this week in California, where Elizabeth Holmes and many of her C-suite colleagues are going through major trials. Here, I think there's some couple of big lessons. You have to prioritize trust. You need to build a reputation as a truth teller. This means go big. Go big on truth. Go big on transparency. And go big on trust. It means that you have to scale a challenger culture, a culture where it's safe and extra duty to speak up about issues, ideas, or indeed concerns. And you need to think about unlocking, activating, and sustaining a trust ecosystem, an ecosystem of trust within your organization, but also with your partners, your suppliers, and of course, your customers. Here we can see some research I've been involved in partnership with London Business School, identifying the trust accelerators, but also the trust derailers. Think more structure, more clarity, more context over control, more values rather than rules, and more care and co-creation rather than command and control. In Africa, there's a term, it stands for Ubuntu. I'll say that again, Ubuntu. And it means I am because we are. What a great value. When you have Ubuntu, when you have high levels of trust vertically and horizontally across the DNA of your organization, it allows your teams and your customers to make trust leaps into the future. Navigating uncertainty, placing faith in new products or services or platforms, and reducing risk. Here we can see a great example from Formula One, where they have the values of courage, equity, excellence, and joy. And they prioritize trust and psychological safety. Because we know that when we have high levels of psychological safety, the return on innovation, return on attention, and indeed return on courage is 3 to 4 times higher. I also know that when you have high levels of trust and psychological safety, you're up to 5x more able to absorb change and absorb the tailwinds and headwinds of transformation. So, catalyst number 2 for you to launch, activate, and sustain is trust as your North Star. Prioritize trust and use it as a navigator alongside all of your product, moral, and ethical decisions. So we arrive at our final catalyst today. And this is what I call new world DNA. Do you have new world DNA or old world DNA as a leader, as an organization, and as a strategy? New world DNA means pursuing both social and business value. It's about mastering that new logic of competition and achieving innovation and resilience through diversity, including cognitive diversity. And it's about designing an organization that's future fit. New world DNA means scaling intelligence and what makes us more human: courage, imagination, compassion, and care. Old DNA is scaling efficiency, rather than scaling intelligence. And it's very easy to get trapped in old world DNA. Darwin said that extinction is the rule and survival is a choice. We know that company lifespans are dying younger and younger, from 60 years to less than 15 years. And most companies on the S&P 500 today have a 1 in 7 chance of survival over the next 7 years. Here we can see the once mighty General Electric. It holds the record for the one company to stay in the industrial Dow Jones for more than 100 years. And we can see its market capitalization at the peak was more than $600 billion. It was a decacorn, one of the most valuable companies on the planet, alongside ExxonMobil. However, why does disruption happen? I think there are 5 big reasons for you to be aware of today. Unhappy customers, or unhappy clients, broken business models, obsolete cost bases, legacy mindsets or legacy cultures where we're not learners, we're knowers, and we protect the status quo, and active inertia. What's the answer? Well, I think scale new world DNA. And what do I mean by that? It's a mindset and a culture set. It means 3 buckets. This is, if you like, a blueprint for a post-pandemic organizational model. It means who we are. That's bucket number 1. Bucket number 2 is how we operate. And bucket number 3 is how we grow. Research at Hat Future Lab has shown that the top 30 companies today, in terms of compound annual growth rate, highest rated cultures. So examples include Beyond Meat, Moderna, that's reimagining healthcare, Beyond Meat, that's reimagining food, Microsoft, that's reimagining into the cloud. These companies, they all have one thing in common. They have new world DNA. They focus on culture contribution, not culture fit. They scale intelligence, not just efficiency. They have challenger cultures where it's extra duty to speak up because it's always less risky to choose silence. And they reimagine the core and reimagine growth engines. So my goal today was to give you the equivalent of a double espresso to invoke the spirit of the US Open champion, Emma Raducanu. I hope you feel more energized, but more importantly, I hope you're thinking about a conversation to have now or a next step action. What are the 5 imperatives, the 5 tips to transform your leadership now? Number 1, 10x those catalysts around harnessing uncertainty. That means harnessing uncertainty as a tailwind and activating and scaling purpose. Trust as North Star and new world DNA. Number 2, scale fearless questions. Remember, questions are the answer. If you want to be more innovative, more transformative, more courageous in the face of massive uncertainty, you need to ask new types of questions. And this means a care and co-creation culture, not a culture of silence or a culture of bureaucracy or a culture of compliance. Number 3, re-energize the core, update your business models to absorb new regulatory or changes in customer preferences, or indeed new competition, and reimagine inclusivity and sustainability, because this is the new world DNA. Number 4, harness the power of we. That means diversity of thinking, positive dissent, differences across cultures, and divergent thinking. Remember, return on intelligence, not just return on investment. And finally, scale curiosity, the curiosity to learn and the courage to unlearn. In the words of Marie Curie, in life, nothing is to be feared, only understood. And the more you understand, the less you will fear. Here are some final practical tools to take away. You'll get a copy of this slide deck as well. It's been a pleasure to meet with you today. Myself and Tahira are looking forward to answering your questions. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Terence. Thank you so much. It's been kind of exciting and quite insightful as well. So thank you.
Thank you so much.
We have a few questions coming down the line here. And I would like to encourage anyone who has a question to ask the question in the feed, and we'll make sure that we answer them. I mean, I love energy and the coverage and the relevance of the topic. So let's dive in and let's go to the first question that we have. And that question is coming from Ioanni. And Ioanni is asking, can you please provide an example of how purpose was developed in a team to handle anxiety?
What a great question, Ioanni. I've been working recently with all types of organizations, not just big legacy companies like HSBC with over 300 people, but smaller high velocity startups like Klarna that's disrupting the credit card market. And there's a tool that I can certainly share with you, and I can speak about it now, which is a purpose DNA tool. And what it does is get the team, because we know that anticipatory anxiety right now, we're worried about health and well-being, we're worried about hybrid, we're worried about all sorts of things. So this is at high levels, and that is an innovation and a performance killer. So you need to be able to articulate the purpose and make it accountable, make it aspirational, and be able to activate it. And what I've created is a very practical purpose canvas. If you email me after this session, I think there's an email up on the slide deck, I can share that canvas with you. And you can use it with your team to start a conversation around how do we connect with purpose? Because if you can connect with purpose at an organizational level, but also make it relevant and meaningful at a personal level, you achieve a purpose dividend, higher levels of engagement, innovation, focus, and it also acts as a no strategy. When you've got a strong why, it helps you to say no, helps you to get a higher return on attention. And we need that more than ever. So connect with me. I can share that tool with you. But in a couple of sentences, it means start a conversation around how do we connect with our purpose? How do we define our purpose at an operational level? What does that look like and sound like? Get the team to define their purpose and then share it and consolidate it. It's a great energizer. I think purpose is a simplifier. It's a multiplier of talent. It's a clarifier as well. So I think it's a great question and a great next step action. Activate purpose and ask yourself one big question. Are you meeting, exceeding, or falling behind on your purpose, your leadership purpose, not just your company purpose? You'll know in your heart what the answer is.
Excellent. Let us move to the next one. And the two are related, so I'll kind of I combine both. It is a question by Gerardo and Richard. The first one is, how do you see culture impacting these catalysts? For example, in culture that are not so entrepreneurial. So that's the first one. I'll just add the second one.
Yes.
Which says, what are examples of catalytic questions, how to find courage to be open. So there are
it's
all
really fantastic. So first of all, let's dive straight into the questions. A really simple tool. Check out Hal Gregerson. He's created a platform called 24-4.com. And basically, it's a great platform to help you generate catalytic questions. A catalytic question is a new type of question that gets you to look at the problem or frame the challenge in a different way. Let me give you an example. Let's say that you want to generate some new thinking and you're in a meeting with your team. What you need to do is allocate around 30 minutes. First of all, agree and pick a challenge. A great way to do that is to think about pain points. What's stopping you from doing your best work, not just your busy work? It could be bad meetings. It could be sloppy feedback. It could be you're not getting the best from each other in terms of communication and engagement. So pick a problem, but just pick one. Step two is generate questions. And don't worry so much about the questions, but generate new types of questions relating to that problem. And sometimes if you defocus, it'll be easier to do. And you should allocate around 10 to 15 minutes to do that, because that creates a time constraint and is more likely to be get a better outcome. Then finally, step three is you then reflect, look at those questions as a team and pick one or two questions that are different. They help you look at that problem differently or challenge an existing assumption or get you to rethink. And that way, it's like a decisional muscle. The more you use that, the stronger and more confident you'll get. So practice it and check out 24-4project.com. which is a great platform for catalytic questions. Number two is, look, everything is evolving, and we know that COVID, digitization, automation are accelerants. And we also, you know, culture is a living thing. A great book to check out is What You Do Is Who You Are. What You Do Is Who You Are by Ben Horowitz, a venture capitalist in Silicon Valley. What You Do Is Who You Are. And it's a really great practical insight on how to scale and update your culture, a culture that helps everybody to elevate what makes them more human. I would recommend a couple of steps. Number one, do a cultural audit. What does your existing culture look like? What are the strengths of that and the blind spots? What are the enablers and what are the barriers of your existing culture? And of course, there are different types of culture as well, which you need to analyze. There's your organizational culture, but also your counterculture and your departmental culture. And we know that culture is not just culture, it's a mindset as well. Number two is, once you've benchmarked your culture, identifying strengths and gaps and blind spots, you need to look at culture as something that happens by design, not by accident. Something that happens by design, not by accident. You need to own the cultural agenda. I know from research at HapFuture Lab and MIT that around 93% of executives agree that culture is more important than strategy, but only 28% agree that culture is a strength. So there's a big opportunity here to step up. And I recommend my book, The 3D Leader, which contains all sorts of practical tools and checklists on how to scale a culture of courage, no matter what the size or the industry that you're in. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Great answer. As you were answering it, culture is more important than strategy. And I couldn't help but thinking the famous thing by Peter Drucker, who says, culture eats strategy for breakfast. And linking to it really was in a research that we did 2 years ago with Harvard Business Review Analytical Service, where we also saw that culture allows you also to break through the silos within the organization. If you have a proper culture, people will be able to find their ways of going through and going beyond the silos and get away, finding a way to collaborate.
This is such a great point, Tiro, because I did some work with Moderna recently and Pfizer. And look, these are big, complex organizations, often drowning in complexity and bureaucracy. But what they've done over the last 18 months is think and act like 10,000 person startups. And they fight complexity, not with complexity, but with culture. And it's a really interesting question. When I met with Stefan Bankal, the CEO of Moderna, he said, culture eats strategy for breakfast, but did COVID eat culture? Because of course, there are two big mega trends that we're having to deal with right now. The first is the hybrid paradox. What is our policy, our strategy in terms of scaling a hybrid workforce? So the hybrid paradox is a major mega trend that we have to deal with right now. And number two is what I call the great reshuffle. And that means that we're all thinking about our purpose. A lot of us are thinking about, why do I do what I do? And for the companies that have the courage and the clarity to connect with that, they're going to create exponential cultures that will accelerate transformation and create truly unbelievable products and services. The companies that turn a blind eye or continue to prioritize 20th century, the last 200 years of management thinking, are the ones that sadly are going to go off like fridge in the yogurt, like yogurt Excellent. In the fridge.
Excellent. I'll put two more questions. One, I'll give you 30 seconds for both.
Okay.
One is, how to connect better when you feel sometimes not enough. I mean, you feel, let's say, confident in preparing forever. So the question really was, what advice would you give to the younger self? So, I mean, maybe one advice or two.
What a great question. When I was writing my first book, I was a pathological perfectionist. And the book was meant to take a year. It took about 3 years. Don't get trapped by perfection. When you get trapped by perfection, you never get started. Focus on iterative mindset, learning, experimenting. And remember that fail, if you think of the word fail, it stands for from action I learn. fail from action I learn. I think it's a great way to look at getting started. And remember, do faster than doubt. When you do, like in a boxing match, you've got do in one corner and doubt in another. Now, if you wait too long, doubt's going to take over and you don't even get started. Do faster than doubt, and you're going to grow in confidence and competence.
Excellent. The last one, before we move to the next, what is the number one action leader should be thinking about today?
It's such an important question, and I would suggest think about attention, because we know that we're suffering from record levels of burnout, technical stress, this sort of gap between well-being and productivity. We need to move from burnout to balance. So I'd focus on attention. Do you have deep focus or shallow focus? What percentage of your week is on shallow focus? And what percentage of your week is on deep focus? Remember, leadership is about scaling attention vertically and horizontally. And you want to get the maximum return on attention. So start with your attention. Where is it going? And are you getting the best return on it?
Thank you so much, Terence. I think this brings us to the end of the presentation here.
It's been a pleasure.
What a delight it's been. What a delight. Hopefully, we take some of the learnings that we've just had. And as you say, the learn, unlearn, and then relearn, and so on, so that at the end of the day, we are in a better position. So really, really big thank you to you.
Thank you, Tara.
Have two more announcements here, and then we'll close the series today. First, of course, we are, excited about bringing this series to you. So we just wanted to give you the heads up in terms of what is coming up. So on October 5th, we'll be having another series called Blockchain-Driven Transformations. And we'll be looking at the power of blockchain and how it has been a transformative force in many of the things that are happening. And then on November 2nd, we'll be welcoming, for November 5th, it will be with Anthony Williams, Emil Anderson, and myself. For November 2nd, we'll be welcoming Robin Speculon, and he will be talking about lessons learned in digital transformation. So stay tuned. And of course, if there is any session or any topic that you want us to discuss in these transformation talks, these are your sessions. So do write to us, do make the suggestion. And if there is a thinker or an executive or a leader that you want to hear here as well, do let us know, and we'll make sure that we work to get the person on board. At least we promise, as you say, we'll be trying. Try, we will do, for sure. And then in closing, I'm really delighted to let you know also that on October 28th and 29th, we're hosting the fourth series of Brightline Strategy at Work. So this year's theme is quite special. It's about embracing and leading perpetual transformation. And I heard you talking a lot.
That looks fantastic.
Exactly, Terence. I heard you talk a lot about beta, perpetual transformation, and so on. So yes. Stay tuned. You can get more information on the website at events.brightline.org. And I'm just listing some of the speakers that are featured. And then there are many more. We're talking about more than 20 speakers for the day of the event. So we look forward, of course, to connect October 5th for the next transformation talk, and of course on October 28th and 29th for Strategy at Work. Stay tuned and let's keep it, as I said, transformation is everywhere. Let's have more successful transformations everywhere. So thank you, and have a good one.
Take care, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.